You've been faithfully fighting mall crime as one of mall security's finest for 2 years now, without rest. And it's time for a vacation. Packing your bags, you hop on a plane and catch your first flight out to see the wonders of Central Africa. After a tour of a blood diamond mine, and with a new appreciation for the amount of human suffering that goes into each diamond wedding ring, you take the bus back to your hotel. But wait, what's that in the middle of the road? A monkey has just wandered in from the jungle and is laying in the middle of the road gasping for air. You and your tour group spill out of the bus and crowd around the monkey. Someone shouts, "Does anyone know CPR?" Then a German man leans down to begin the life-saving procedure on the dying simian. But you knock him out of the way. You've read up on monkeypox. The World Health Organization has called it an international threat, and you're not allowing another global pandemic to start on your watch. Without CPR, the monkey passes away. Sad. But you've just averted an international health disaster. And that's when a rat runs by and bites you in the ankle before scampering off into the jungle. The monkey was a distraction. The rat was the infected one all along. But you had no way of knowing that despite it being called monkeypox, this dangerous disease is actually mostly spread by rodents. And that's exactly how the rodents want it to stay. Unaware of the dangerous pathogen in your system, you bandage up the drive-by rodent bite and load back up on the bus. You finish your tour of the bloodiest of Africa's diamond mines, and before you realize that your vacation has come to an end, it's time to fly back to America and defend this nation's malls from shoplifters, loiterers, and skateboarders. But on the last day of your trip, you start feeling sick. You got a bit of a headache, but you're more concerned about that outbreak of acne that's appeared on your normally flawless skin, and it's spread across your face. That's weird, you haven't had zits since you were 16. But you chalk it up to the traveling, blood diamond mine tours, and general excitement. And the next day, you're boarding a flight for home. You flew coach to save money on your trip, and during the long 16-hour flight back home, you and your two aisle mates are basically breathing each other's air. That's bad news for them because monkeypox can be transmitted through respiration if you're both really intimately close to each other. You actually have such a grand time on your flight that when the plane lands in the US, you decide to say goodbye to every single passenger in the flight crew European style with a kiss on the cheek. You might be a man of culture, but you've just spread monkeypox to over 150 people because monkeypox is also transmitted through close, intimate contact such as kissing or sex. You grab a taxi home and kiss your taxi driver goodbye on the cheek as well as he drops you off, then settle in. Man, you must be jet-lagged because you've been feeling really exhausted lately. But that's not normal exhaustion or jet lag. That's your body trying to fend off the monkeypox infection that's now hijacking your immune system so it can replicate out of control. To make matters even worse for everyone else you've been kissing goodbye European style, your rash is literally rubbing off on them, with smallpox pathogen secreted by the pimple-like rash and scabs left on your quickly cratering face. The next day, you report for duty at your local mall, but you're really having to push yourself to show up. On top of your exhaustion and crater-like face, you've falsely attributed to acne. You also start to experience chills and muscle aches. It's like having the flu, but 10 times worse. Despite this, you soldier on because mall crime never takes a break, so neither can you. The teenagers and one creepy guy in his 40s who runs Spencer's are counting on you. As the day progresses, though, you know you're slowing down. You're struggling to keep up with shoplifters and kids riding their skateboards indoors, and your preventative CPR of random strangers is not just unnecessary and unwanted, but downright physically exhausting. You don't remember being this tired before your vacation, and that acne on your face is only getting worse. The sores you thought were pimples are now starting to appear inside your mouth and are spreading to your hands, chest, and even genitals. Something is definitely up, but thankfully you live in America, which has some of the most modern medicine in the world. And that means going to that chick in the mall who sells crystals for health advice, because like many Americans, you can't afford any of the good stuff. She tells you that Azurite is good for your health, so you load up on Azurite and haul it home, determined to get healthy through the power of modern American crystal medicine and positive thinking. Man, you can't believe how lucky you are to live in the first world. The next day, though, you can't get out of bed. Your rash has now turned into lesions that hurt to touch. When you turn your head on your pillow, the pain of it jolts you awake, and you're horrified to discover that those lesions have now spread to your most private parts. Something's definitely up, and these crystals didn't do squat. So you head to your nearest emergency room, trying your hardest not to think about how this hospital bill will be the reason you never own a home. At the emergency room, the doctors are immediately alarmed as you present your symptoms and refuse to greet you with a European-style kiss despite your insisting on it. In fact, they ask you to stop trying to greet the rest of the ER patients in the same way because they're suspicious that you've got the monkeypox. You're quickly brought to the back and threatened with restraints if you don't stop trying to greet staff with a European kiss. But soon a doctor comes to inspect you with gloved hands and feels your lymph nodes. They're swollen. Your doctor goes over the checklist one more time. Fever, headache, muscle aches with back pain, a rash that's turned into lesions and covers your face, chest, genitals, and hands, chills, exhaustion, and now swollen lymph nodes. Yep, you got the monkeypox, and you're quickly shuffled away to quarantine. You're now one of the nearly 3,000 cases of monkeypox documented in the US since the start of this year, and the disease has exploded across the world, prompting the World Health Organization to declare it a public health emergency. A representative from the CDC soon comes to your room as your health deteriorates further. They interrogate you on all the movements since you started feeling symptoms, trying to track your spread of the disease. You tell them about all those European kisses, and he slams his fist on the table in frustration. Damn, man, why'd you have to be such a man of culture? Tracking this outbreak will be next to impossible. They break the worst of the news to you. Monkeypox is fatal in 1 out of 10 people so far, but nobody in the US has died of the disease yet. The disease lasts up to 4 weeks, so you'll soon know if you're going to become the famous first American casualty of monkeypox. If you've been immunized against smallpox, you have a very good chance of not even getting sick from monkeypox, but the US stopped immunizing for smallpox in 1972, seeing as how the disease had basically been eradicated by then. Damn their short-term thinking. You rage silently as you struggle to breathe through the worsening physical exhaustion. Your lesions have popped open, leaking a yellowish pus that's chock full of the monkeypox virus. You're tended to every day by medical staff wearing full plastic bodysuits, and you've only been allowed to see your friends and family via the iPad the staff brought to you. You're turning the corner, starting to feel better, the exhaustion is lifting, and the lesions that covered your body are also receding. The muscle aches and pains are also getting better. You're overjoyed. You beat this monkeypox virus. Wait, monkeypox? Now that your head's clear, you're able to remember things a bit more clearly. Your doctor asked you how you might have gotten infected, and you told them about the dying wheezing monkey and how you stopped that German man from giving it CPR, but you forgot about the mouse running by and biting you in the ankle, because that's the real vector for the spread of the disease, rodents. It all makes sense. That mouse used the monkey as a distraction. You sit up in the bed, filled with renewed vigor, and press the call button. You've got to let the CDC guy know how this all started. The door opens and a new doctor comes in. Huh, never seen this doctor before. He's short, like really short, only a few inches tall really, with a long pink tail. But he's got a lab coat with a name badge and everything, so you shrug your suspicions off. The doctor climbs up onto your bed and you tell him everything. But this time you tell him about the mouse that bit you. You tell him how that mouse used the monkey as a distraction. It's the mice, doctor, the mice, not the monkeys, you shout excitedly. Hmm, mice, you say? There's something odd about the way this doctor speaks, mostly because he's squeaking a lot. Well, plenty of doctors in the US are immigrants seeking better lives for themselves and their families. You're not going to be xenophobic about it. But then that doctor grabs your pillow and holds it over your face, pressing you down onto the bed. You fight and struggle. Why is the doctor doing this? Then you see it. Long pink tail, standing only a few inches tall. Adorable round ears. My God, you realize with dawning horror as you struggle for breath, the doctor is also a rodent.
It's not the monkeys. It's not the monkeys.
You try to shout through your pillow, but it's too late. Soon it goes dark for the last time, and you peacefully slip away. Now go check out what is it actually like to have COVID, or click this other video instead.